we have to consider not a one-by-one variable situation, but a combination of these different factors. That is probably the best way to understand what happens in each country. And it means that we can not assert that one single solution, for example, the inclusiveness of union strategies, or the creation of a hybrid status, or fiscal support can be the solution. It's a combination of these variables in a particular national context that can explain more or less the higher or the lower level of social protection offered. And it's also by exploring other kinds of solutions. So we will explore them later in the afternoon, but we know that the enforcement of existing laws, but also the redefinition of what is employment, but also what is an employer. You know that there is a huge debate everywhere about the platforms, for example. Are they employers or not? They don't consider themselves as an employer, of course. But this is very important to take that this issues into consideration. And also to take into consideration other factors, institutional factors, for example, legal, political, cultural, economic factors in each country. Just to take an example, you have probably noticed that Sweden and Slovenia are the two countries we study in which you have a universal access to social protection. It's nice. But if you consider the economic level of these two countries, there is, of course, a huge difference between them. So it means that self-employed people are much more covered and with a much more comfortable situation in Sweden than in Slovenia. So we must consider a cluster of factors rather than only one factor separately. So our analysis leads to the conclusion that, of course, one-size-fits-all policy is not a sustainable solution. Of course, we can fix objectives like in the document we received this week from the European Union. Okay, we should go towards a universal protection for everybody, whatever the status. It's a nice and generous objective, of course. But our analysis showed that we must go much more in details in each country to understand what happens with the unions, what happens with the fiscal measures, what happens with the regulatory framework in each country. And it's probably with a combination specific to each country, so that we can understand what happens. So we plead for a multidimensional and a contextual approach of social protection for self-employed people. You know, it's at least the result of our transversal analysis. So thank you for your attention. And I think we have two discussions.
Et Bernard Gazier, professeur émérite de l'Université de Paris 1. And we, after this discussion, we can open a more broad discussion in the panel.
Good morning, and so I'm Sandrine Kaz, I'm an economist, I work at the OECD on labor market segmentation. So you understand from my comments also that I will also come to the topic from that angle. So first of all, thank you for the presentation. I think there was more in the slide than in the paper, so that was quite interesting and useful. I think indeed it's important to probably reflect about the categories of non-standard workers, how they sleep through the social safety net. Because national social protection systems have primarily been developed to protect standard workers, right? And considering non-standard workers, except self-employed, usually they have same access and rights. The problem is the duration of contribution, etc., which de facto make them kind of not having the same level of protection. Well, I think for self-employed, indeed, it's a different animal, so it's a different question. And the situation is more complex because you have to, in general, articulate those non-insurance-based benefits versus the one organized on the insurance basis, right? So why is that, I think, element important? Because if you reflect in terms of segmentation, right, labor market segmentation, you may have precisely some segmentation arising from different types of contracts, this contractual segmentation that very often has led many economies to reflect in terms of the type of employment protection rights workers were having. While I think in that context, it's really the differences in social security contribution, etc., that may generate different outcomes, right, in terms of, I would say, more broadly, job quality outcomes, not only talking about social rights. So maybe to just add a few figures, I think, to what you said, that's, I think, comes from the Commission. You have, looking at the actual coverage of self-employed, so not what is set by law, right, but effective coverage, 55% share of self-employed in the EU at risk of not being entitled to unemployment benefits. 38% share of self-employed, again, at risk of not being entitled to sickness benefits. And finally, 46%, the share of self-employed women in the EU at risk of not being entitled to maternity benefits. So all this to say that second point that indeed, having also in mind a sort of de facto, actual, right, effective protection you get versus what law provides is another key element. Now coming maybe to the paper itself, the first point I would like to make is related to target population. There was a very interesting presentation this morning, and well, I think all these efforts we all try to make to articulate and disentangle the different categories. So solo, self-employed, IPROs, self-employment with or without employees, etc. One question I had is what we consider, for instance, particularly important categories in this discussion on labor market segmentation is the dependent self-employed workers. So I was wondering to which extent those dependent self-employed workers, that is the category of on-account workers that have only one client, they cannot grow, they cannot hire, they cannot take any autonomous decision, etc., or to which extent are they different from this IPRO category? Because dependent self-employed workers provide both a very high entrepreneurial risk, low protection, and in a way they are dependent, they are in this sort of subordinated relation. I think that's particularly important also to characterize the profile of these people. I mean, knowing whether these people are rather young people, low skill, high skill, etc., but also quite importantly, whether the fact of being in that situation is a voluntary decision or not. I think to me it's from the perspective of job quality, it's an extremely important dimension. Moving to the drivers, and you look at different institutional drivers. I found particularly important and useful this big table you have where you look at the different benefits. And maybe one way to sort of make a better use of this table, which indeed is quite detailed, etc., but you may kind of get lost and say, so what, from there, where do I go? It could be quite useful maybe to sort of identify sort of priorities. So you have different countries, different benefits. So categorized, for instance, in terms of comparing to regular standard workers, to which extent they have the same rules or different rules, or they have no benefits at all, right? I'm talking about the self-employed, or there is some optional enrollment. Because having a sort of, you know, categorizing maybe with colors or something, you would immediately see, okay, what is most urgent, right, in terms of policy. I mean, I would tend to say probably unemployment insurance, access to unemployment insurance benefit, but maybe we can discuss. The section on fiscal incentives and fiscal support, I was a little bit confused, but maybe this is because this is quite short in the paper, because somehow fiscal incentives are mostly in place to generate support, right, self-employment. So to which extent it was more specifically linked to this question of improving right, the access and the quality and the level of social protection was not absolutely clear to me. Social dialogue. So social dialogue, well, extremely important, indeed, and I think it's transversal too, actually. I mean, social dialogue is really something that can help addressing more broadly all the question of working conditions, right? I mean, not only, of course, social security, but also access to training and other different dimensions for managing transitions as well. So I think you were saying you were a little bit disappointed by the result, right? That's, I mean, how come at the end social dialogue and collective bargaining can contribute to enhance more the situation of self-employed? Maybe a couple of observations. You, in the paper, you concentrate mostly on trade union density and coverage, right? And I think we something that you may need to sort of reflect, particularly important for inclusiveness, is to look at the systems as a whole, or broadly, look at other dimensions. We produced a chapter last year in Employment Outlook, where sort of argument is to say precisely more often, too much attention has been devoted only to trade union density and coverage. There are other important dimensions, coordination, the different divides that exist, right? Extension, you talk about extension, but also derogations, opt-out mechanism, many other things, and overall the quality of labor relations, right? So I think maybe it's complicated, I know. But maybe looking more broadly at the system, how it functions as a whole, would provide different results. And as a matter of fact, we are currently working on a forthcoming chapter which looks more generally how the different collective bargaining systems in OECD function and how they deliver in terms of, now it's more in terms of employment, unemployment, so more macro variables also, but to some extent also to inclusiveness, right? So for instance, the share of temporary contracts or different levels of unemployment for young people, women, etc. And we found that it matters, actually, for inclusiveness. Not all systems, depends how they're organized, but they can matter. And finally, so collective bargaining, social dialogue, I know we'll discuss it this afternoon. So it's true, potentially a powerful instrument, but of course there are a lot of challenges. And in particular for these categories, I mean, it's complicated also to give voice to non-standard. there may be also some regulatory challenges. I mean, I'm not a legal expert, but I don't know to which extent independent workers organizing, to which extent this could constitute a sort of, bridge to anti-competitive law. I mean, I don't know, this could be an issue. And maybe finally, giving the micro to Bernard, about the general policy message that you have at the end, I cannot more than agree to say that, I mean, you cannot have a pragmatic policy answer. You have to reflect and consider the package. also extremely important to put things in national context. Right? When you're going to say in one country, it won't not work in another country because of the social fabric and all the different institutional settings and challenges you have in the different country. But maybe one way to sort of, because if at the end of the day, your very first question is about how to improve social protection and social protection for self-employed, maybe one way to sort of group a little bit the solution would be, on the one hand, to look at what can be done to sort of repair or fix what is already there, right, in place. Typically, okay, how can we address the question of tax avoidance? How can you reduce abuse or this question of misclassification status, etc., versus more like replace? So you want to discuss policy answers such as basic income or individual account, and these big questions, right? So maybe sort of defining sort of key, how to say, objective or principle questions, such as do we want to equalize social rights between the different categories, and so how do we do it? And then do we want also to sort of reflect on a more general reflection about tying social protection and requirements to individual versus to jobs, right? And even the usual question. And thank you, I stop here.
Do we answer each of you separately or together?
Okay.
I'm afraid.
No, I will start. Thank you so much. Well, I think the exercise of the hearing is actually is a very difficult one, and you could make very simple results about from a very big complexity, and I think it's kind of a tour de force, because sometimes it looks simplistic, but it has a contribution of saying something, presenting different levels, thresholds, and so on. So it's a very useful way of organizing the discussion. I think you got kind of a pragmatic stance. You are trying to gauge some levels that could be, you say sustainable, what is really sustainable in the international comparison? So it remains to be discussed. What is attractive, what is sustainable, is it budget balanced, who pays, and so on. So I think you have a mass of questions behind sustainable. But anyhow, I think you are completely right by connecting institution strategies, even if it is in a very broad manner. I think that I would like to underline that sometimes the discussion you present is somehow static, as if at one period today, several institutions, several devices, several resources are present, and that is a picture we deal with. But I think it's an evolving picture, and it could be useful to have a look at more dynamic processes. Sometimes you don't, but I think it could be worth insisting a little more on that, and especially when you have fiscal support that takes more or less the place of specific protection, but of course it is not the same role, it is a buffer substitute, and it leads to alternative way of dealing with problems, and so you have a dynamic picture, and not only a combination of several elements that are to be put together. So it's an interactive picture that will be discussed. I think that when you discuss about a sustainable situation, I think the last word would be, are you or are you not protected, and do you feel or don't feel protected? And there is some elements in the survey regarding this aspect. And of course, if you want to go beyond, you have to select the areas where we are or we are not protected, and we feel or we don't feel protected. This leads me to three different questions. The first one has to do with Espinn Andersen. You say Espinn Andersen is of no use either. Well, Espinn Andersen is of course the defense and promotion of the Nordic model. And when you look at Sweden, Sweden does a very good job protecting part of this worker. So the universalistic version of Espinn Andersen model works pretty well. And as Sandrine said, most of the system has been devised for helping salaried workers. Okay, but now we are at the borderline, we are just at the limit, and of course if you have a universal system, the system can deal with that. Other systems cannot. So they have to extend, to adapt, to invent something else, to correct. And so I think that we can read your contribution by the illustration of the relevance of one aspect of Espinn Andersen that is now more and more useful because it integrates every kind of worker, and the limits and the way by which other systems try to cope more or less with the situation. And then it could be useful to go a little behind this being on the side.